views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
This is Bobby C. for Sports NYC, and we're out at MetLife Stadium in New Jersey as the show celebrates the return of the NFL season. We'll catch up with WFAN's Mike Mancuso and talk some Giants and Jets football. Then we'll take a look on the show about the Nets and the Knicks, which are returning here in the preseason as basketball is also back. Then we'll wrap the show with a special feature on handball star Timbo Gonzalez of the Bronx, and also take a look at the Orchard Beach Car Show, which gives back so much to the families of 9/11. All that and more is coming up next, so keep it locked. This is Sports NYC. NFL season here on Sports NYC, but things not looking too good for the New York Jets. Joined now by Mike Mancuso of WFAN. Mike, such an honor to have you on the show. You've been a longtime friend. Great to have you on the show.
Thank you, Bobby.
So the Jets, it's kind of been a nightmare start for them. And this game in particular in week four against the Seattle Seahawks, no different. Another tough day for the offense.
And you know what? I think you also have to look at the defense too, because the offense struggled, no doubt. But the defense allowed an 85-yard drive in the first half, a 92-yard drive in the first half, and they really didn't get Seattle off the field. So, yes, the Jets' offense struggled. Fitzpatrick wasn't great again. There were three interceptions, although two might not have been his fault. Nonetheless, not a good performance by the offense. When you have those types of long drives, like Seattle did on offense, Fitzpatrick and the Jets' offense was on the sidelines for most of that. But when we did get to see Marshall go up against Sherman, it was interesting. They were challenging him. I think not having Decker really hurt the Jets a bit because, you know, Seattle was able to move, you know, their defensive coverage toward Marshall. And Sherman, you know, he did allow some catches and Marshall made some plays, but at the end of the day, Sherman had the two interceptions and Seattle won the game.
So now, in your perspective, what do you think the Jets need to do? Because, I mean, the road for them just continues to get tougher. I mean, they got Pittsburgh coming up, they got Arizona coming up, a lot of tough games, and they're on the road.
And I think it might be to their benefit that they're on the road because this fan base was not happy, and it hasn't been happy, and they have no reason to be happy the way this has started. I think they're going to get a win out of these next two games. Don't ask me how. I think they'll step up and get one. And then it's all about how they finish the season. And I still think it'll be Ryan Fitzpatrick at quarterback. I don't think you can lay all this on him. The defense has to play better. It'll be interesting. If they need to get one of the next two games on the road, and if they don't, it could be a long season.
We got the post-game reaction from the Jets and also from the Seattle Seahawks. We got a chance to catch up with Richard Sherman and Russell Wilson in the post-game press conference. Check it out.
We definitely need to find ways to win. You know, we have to take it one week at a time. You know, we have a good football team, too. You know, I know you kind of froze up when you said it, but I definitely think we have a good football team. We just have to go out there and play better.
I think we're out of sync right now. I don't think we're not really hitting on all cylinders, so to speak. You know, the run game today, especially, you know, winning a lot out there. And when we do that, it puts a lot of pressure on the passing game, and they have to work together.
You know, I knew coming into this game that it'd be a dogfight. You know, with Brandon, he's going to end up in the Hall of Fame with a gold jacket because he's done it everywhere he's been. He did it in Miami. He did it in he's doing it in New York. He did it in Denver. He's just a great player, and he's going to make his plays. And I knew that coming in. That's how the matchups go.
Feeling great though. You know, I thought the offensive line did a phenomenal job. They protected really well. We played physical. Guys were lights out catching the football. You see the playmakers that we have, and it makes it easy on me in terms of throwing the ball and getting the ball out on time and letting those guys, you know, be true playmakers that they are. So
you couldn't ask for that's like cherry on top. Because like I said, it's been a crazy week, man, especially flying from different time zones and trying to learn the plays that was going in for this game. You couldn't ask for nothing better. And then on top, you come away with a win. That's the most important thing to me. Touchdowns and all that stuff is great, but at the end of the day, you want to win and keep trying to stack them. So I'm glad that we was able to get a win today.
So the Jets open up the season with a very tough game. I actually thought that they would be a playoff team this year, but right now it doesn't look that way.
And they still might be. but a lot has to change. And, you know, with two road games coming up, they have a lot of work to do. And I think you'll see, you know, like I said, they get one out of the next two, they still have a shot because they have a lot of home games. You know, they would have started the season 6 out of 9 on the road. And, you know, that's not easy.
And some easier opponents, too, after these next two games.
And they're also going to have some primetime games at home, too. I think 3 games are night games. You know, on Sunday night against the Patriots, you have a Saturday night game against the Dolphins. So, you know, if they can be in a spot where they're still alive, they'll have a lot to play for. Judging by the defense and the weapons that they had on offense, I think that was, you know, a very reasonable expectation to put on this team. And they still could reach it, but it's going to be a lot of heavy lifting.
A lot of highs and lows so far, too, for them as well through the first 4 weeks of the season, because they open up with a tough opponent in Cincinnati. But again, I expected them to win that opening game. They played so well, and Ryan Fitzpatrick had his best game in Buffalo in week 2, and then they come back with a real dud, 6 interceptions for Fitz in week 3 in Kansas City. Another game that I thought that they could win.
Yeah, that was going to be tough, but you can't turn the ball over 8 times on the road, even at home, and expect to win. So, yes, they've shot themselves in the foot. A lot of that's correctable, penalties, not getting it done, drop passes. You know, you just can't win in the NFL like that or in any league. So they have to clean it up. Are they capable of doing it? I think so. And again, you can't hang all of this on him, but he is a stopgap until they can find someone to be their next franchise quarterback. Where that comes from, I don't know. But, you know, he's got to start playing better.
But, again, I think this has got a chance to be a very, very good football team. And we heard it in the post game in the locker room. A lot of the players, of course, still very optimistic about the kind of year they could have.
Well, they have to be. I mean, it's only a quarter of the way done. They're professional players with a lot of expectations. There's a lot of talent in that room. The coaching staff still only in its second year, so they have to work through some things. But you know what? Right now, they're probably preparing for these next two road games coming up. So, like I said, I think they'll get one of the next two, and then we see what happens.
And, you know, I was surprised, too, a lot of the fans calling for Geno Smith. I mean, I don't expect to see him hit the field, even if Fitz is having a tough game.
You know what? The backup quarterback is always the most popular person on a team that's not winning, and even Geno Smith, as unpopular as he is, he was getting some calls today. I think you're going to start getting calls for Bryce Petty if Fitzpatrick doesn't play well in the next couple of weeks. But, you know, think about who they have to play, and that's going to be a tough road to hold.
So some ups and downs for Fitzpatrick and some ups and downs as well for Darrelle Revis, who hasn't gotten off to a great start, and even some injuries for him. What do you expect from him the rest of the way?
He had a thigh or a hamstring issue today. He didn't finish the game. You know how teams are with injuries. They're not going to be coming, you know, up with a lot of information. So it remains to be seen. You know, we've been around a long time. You know how a hamstring injury can really put a guy on the bench for quite a few weeks. So, you know, we'll see what happens. He's getting up in age. He has been banged up. He's had a variety of different injuries. And if he's not playing, even at the level that he was playing this year, that's a big loss for the Jets.
That was all the buzz in week 1 as Bengals wide receiver A.J. Green got the better of Revis. We go back inside the locker room for more.
Every game is disappointing. We're extremely disappointed, you know, but we'll figure it out and we'll watch film and see how we can bounce back.
I think anytime you're in the red zone and you don't capitalize on those that field position and things like that, I think it's a lack of execution. You know, plays are called, plays are plays, and if, you know, you run the play and we don't block it right, or we don't run the right routes or something, or, you know, whatever the case is, then it's not going to be successful.
We know that we have a quick turnaround, so we're going to watch film, get it out the way. And but at the same time, we're not just going to look through it. We're going to fix our mistakes.
Well, first, we got to take 1 week at a time. This was a very physical game, you know, for both ball clubs, and we definitely got to take care of our bodies these next couple of days. We got a quick turnaround tomorrow. We practice, and we got to get ready for Buffalo. So we got to let this one go. I mean, by midnight tonight, we got to, you know, flush it down the toilet and continue to focus on Buffalo.
So the Jets start out 1-3 through the first 4 weeks. The Giants, meanwhile, have started pretty strong, but last week's game against Washington, not very good.
No, that's one of those games where, you know, toward the end of the season, you can look at it and say, that's the one that kept us out of the playoffs, or that's the one that kept us from getting a home game. That's one that they needed to have back. So, you know what? 2-1, have to go into Minnesota. It's not going to be easy. The offensive line has a lot to prove. Eli has to play better. The defense has to play better. It's one of those situations where it's a good thing they have a little bit of a cushion, because no matter what happens in Minnesota, they're at least 2-2. But, you know, that's a game that's going to hurt them. Last year, there were some games where they just mismanaged the game, be it the coaching staff with the clock or what kind of plays they ran down the stretch, and I think that really bit them big time. I think this year they just got outplayed and didn't play well against the Redskins. You know, they had, you know, turnovers with Eli making a couple of bad decisions. The defense didn't come up big at the end. You had the little sideshow with Beckham last week. Little things that, you know, at the end of that game against the Redskins hurt them. But I think that, you know, a lot of people don't expect much against Minnesota. But like I said, at the very least, they're 2-2 after four games. But, you know, maybe they pull one off in Minnesota.
Well, the Giants able to pull out a squeaker in week one in Dallas, and maybe that was a game that was gifted to them. So, you know, again, that same type of thing where it comes back around in the Washington game.
Yeah, running out of bounds and watching the clock and paying attention to all those little details. Because, you know, there's so much parity, Bobby. At the end of the day, the team that makes one less mental error maybe wins the game. And you see mental errors and mistakes in every one of these games. There's less training camp. You know, players aren't prepared as well going into the early part of the season. So it's all about taking advantage of opportunities. So, you know, Manning and the Giants, you know, they have that pedigree, although the last couple of years have been rough. They're still in a position that they can do something, especially in the NFC, although who figured Philadelphia would get off to such a good start.
Giants certainly looked very strong in their home opener against the New Orleans Saints. Check this out.
This is Bobby C. reporting from MetLife Stadium on an afternoon when the Giant offense wasn't exactly right. It took a very strong defensive effort for Big Blue as they would prevail over the New Orleans Saints 16-13. As time expires, it's kicker Josh Brown sending it through the uprights for the victory. Giant safety Landon Collins had a big safety blitz early in the first half as Drew Brees would move into third all-time on the NFL's career passing list. Giants still did a great job of containing Brees this afternoon.
What was the game plan coming in, and did you guys feel like you executed what the coach had in mind?
Yeah, definitely. Just stop the running down. Definitely get Brees off the spot and so he doesn't see those open receivers if we have any. All right, and just make a play when he throws the ball.
Although the Giant offense really didn't get into the end zone, their wide receivers made some big plays, and that included rookie Sterling Shepard, who had 8 catches, 8 targets, and 117 yards.
I got hit pretty hard on the first catch I got today, and I felt like after that everything slows down, and that's usually how it goes for me. I mean, I just need to catch one ball, and then I'm calm, then all the jitters are pretty much gone. So, you know, it definitely slowed down after that, and see it slowing down even more.
Shepard says he's learning a lot from Victor Cruz, and Victor Cruz certainly looks back this year after injury. He had a crucial first down on that final drive.
I wanted to kind of just work my way in, catch the ball, catch things that are in front of me, make the plays that are presented to me. But, you know, to make a game-winning touchdown catch a week ago and to come in and make a pretty decisive catch on the sideline to pretty much seal the game, I mean, I can't draw it up any other way, man. I don't know, you know, I just go out there and play the game. And I think I'm getting better as these weeks go on, as these practices continue. And I just want to continue to build off that.
Giants definitely look great against New Orleans and Drew Brees. And, you know, for one, the thing for me watching them against the Redskins was that just kind of their defense, which is much improved from last year, so bad last year. You mentioned some of the games that they kind of gave away last year. But, they kind of let Washington kind of hang around in that game.
Yeah, they did. And, you know, you spend so much money on defense and you expect that it's going to lift the level of play to a certain level. And I think it has, and I think it will. But, you know, that was a blip on the season. The defense allowed too many points against the Redskins. You know, theoretically, they scored enough. They're just going to have to play better. And, you know, they need these guys to lift their game. Jenkins, with, you know, the way he played, or you know, he's showing that as a cornerback, he's going to be worth the investment, okay? The rest of them have to do the same.
So Minnesota 3-0. I mean, you mentioned Philadelphia. They get rid of Bradford. Now he lands in Minnesota. They lose their starting quarterback. They lose Adrian Peterson, who's, of course, an NFL legend. They're 3-0 to start the season. Sometimes no rhyme or reason, really, when it comes to the NFL. Do you see the Giants winning on Monday Night Football, and how do you see them going the rest of the way?
You know, I think they'll be talking about fighting for a playoff spot. You know, we talked about the Jets being a 9 or 10 win team. I think the Giants will fall into that category. I think there are some teams that are on their schedule that they should be able to handle. So the Redskin game aside, I think they'll play well against Minnesota. I don't know how strong the offensive line will be, so the defense is going to have to step up if they have any chance of winning that game. Manning has never traditionally played well against Minnesota, so he probably will have something to try to prove. But I think, you know, the way the schedule plays out, I know they have a game against the Packers on a Sunday night, and then they play Baltimore at home, and the Ravens are off to a pretty good start. So, you know, you talk about how tough the Jets schedule is. The Giants schedule at this point is no cakewalk either. So I do think the Giants will have enough to fight for a playoff spot, if not still win the division, because Philly, I still think, will come back a little bit. And it might just come down to when the Giants play the Eagles.
Yeah, at the outset, I had the Giants at a 10 or 11 win team. I actually thought that they could go 11-5 and win the East.
I would have had 9-7 and maybe still winning the East, because I thought the East wouldn't be strong. I didn't think the Eagles would get off to such a fast start. So maybe now 9 or 10 wins will be needed to win the division, but then depends how the rest of the conference plays out. They can still play for a wild card.
Well, 9-7 has always been a good number for the Giants.
Yeah, why not, right? It's had some good ended well for them before.
With the Super Bowls. So, you know, a couple of quick points before we let you go. I think with the Giants, you know, we talk about the upgraded defense, but just so great to see Victor Cruz back playing well off the injury. And, of course, this new kid receiver, Sterling Shepard, has been great as well.
Again, plenty of tools for Eli. I mean, you know, they're hurting at running back a little bit. You know, so that's a concern. But, yes, the offensive weapons are there. They have to protect him, let him get the passing game going. And I think he does have a lot of weapons to use. You know, you kind of wish Vereen was back, because I don't think they used him properly as a pass-catching running back. So I think they'll miss him. But, yes, it's going to be exciting to see the offense. Yeah, Jennings is backed up as well. But Jennings was not really the pass-catching running back that Vereen was brought in to be. And you know, Jennings, a good runner, but I think he's more of a backup back. So we'll see what they do. I mean, they do need something at running back, and I'm sure they're looking at the waiver wires and seeing if they can maybe pick somebody up. But, yes, the offense is going to go as far as Eli and the receivers take them.
That was another one of the storylines coming into the matchup with Washington. It was all about Beckham and Josh Norman, who have plenty of history together already. Afternoon when Giants quarterback Eli Manning would throw for 350 yards against the rival Washington Redskins. It was two interceptions and two fumbles by the big blue quarterback that would be costly. Giants end up with double-digit penalties and an eventual 29-27 defeat to the Redskins.
Obviously, you come in and you're confident. You've been in this position before. You want to go out there and score for your team to win the game, as we've done in times before, but today wasn't our day.
We had a chance to go out there and win a game, get the 3-0, 2-0 in the division, and we didn't take advantage of the opportunity. We can't beat ourselves. You can't go out there and play against good teams and get penalties like that, and it showed.
Clearly, no love lost in the Redskins locker room.
How much did the Giants bring the best out of you and the best out of this team?
Oh, man, you know, really, when it comes down to playing on the field, you know, I've never been a guy that liked that team, you know. It's just something about playing them. Gets me heated up, gets me pumped up and ready to go out there and, you know, torch them any way I can.
Those guys don't like us and we don't like them, man. So every time we go out and play them guys, it's gonna be a fight, man. Hopefully we come out and win that fight, and we did today.
All the pregame talk centered around cornerback Josh Norman and last season's meltdown by Odell Beckham Jr. when Norman was in Carolina. Now in Washington, it was Norman who had the last laugh.
Can't ask nothing better than that. All the stuff in between that was show. At the end of the day, W all that matter. And man, I'm gonna be on this high for a while, so.
So Mike, interesting NFL season already with the Giants and the Jets, and you're here all the time covering all the games. You know, what has been the best part now as a veteran working at the Fan doing this?
You hear people saying these guys really care as much as they do. And yes, they do. They play hard, you know, especially in the NFL where the life expectancy of a player is, I don't even know if it's 4 years. So you just watch these guys compete on an everyday level, and it's fun to be a part of.
So where can the fans catch up with you? I mean, in terms of social media and to link up as well?
You know what? I'm not too much of a social media guy. You'll hear me doing reports from the Garden for Knicks and Ranger games on FAN. But you know what? I don't even have a Twitter account. So
I just got to listen to you.
Yeah, just listen. Thank you.
We'll take a quick timeout here on Sports NYC and be back with more.
Are we there yet?
Yep. We're here.
It's a short drive from your neighborhood to your naturehood. To find a neighborhood park or green space near you, visit discovertheforest.org.
Welcome back on Sports NYC. The month of September isn't just about the return of the NFL season. It's also about the return of the NBA season, which is in the preseason. We got a chance to catch up with some of your favorite New York Knicks in training camp.
I don't think there's been this type of excitement surrounding our team since I've been here over the past couple years. Being in the gym, being around guys, talking to guys, the focus level is at an all-time high.
What makes this year's a little bit different is that I have a lot more options. I have shooters and I could like play through someone like almost the entire game, and someone is mellow, or it could be KP. Like KP, he's been working his butt off too, but just having so many options, and I'm able to play the way that I normally know how to play.
Number one thing is for all of us to stay healthy. We had some history, players getting hurt, and then myself, I got hurt last season. We just got to make sure we get enough rest, and so we're ready for every game. And if we do that, then I don't see any other obstacles why we can be a good team.
Well, I'm very excited to first of all be here in New York City playing the Mecca. A new opportunity. I feel like it's like the beginning again for me. I feel like it's the second half of my career, and I want to make the best of it.
The return of every season is all about optimism. The New York Knicks are very optimistic, and so are the Brooklyn Nets, who have a brand new rookie who is from the Big Apple. This is Bobby C, and the journey of the first Brooklyn-born Net starts right here in Coney Island.
Welcome, everyone. We're thrilled to have you out here in Coney Island, the home of Isaiah Whitehead, as we introduce him officially as the newest member of the Brooklyn Nets.
These young people are seeing a Brooklyn-born player coming to the Brooklyn Nets. It's the right message at the right time. We welcome you, we thank you, and we know he's going to be inspiring to all of these young people here.
I think he's a humble guy, but I think he's hungry and he wants to prove something. I think there are questions about him. Obviously, he'd be a first-round pick or a lottery pick if people thought he was great. So that feeds into what we're doing.
I'm real confident. I mean, that's one of the traits about me. I'm just real competitive and real confident. I mean, I would never back down from anyone, so I mean, I feel like I can play on a level.
His size is, that's important. His versatility and his ability to score the ball away from the ball. But what really attracted me personally to him was his passing ability. I think I was very impressed at how he, especially in the pick and roll, how he can make different reads, his basketball IQ. So we're excited about that.
And it's amazing. I mean, I'm still speechless about it. Just like I said, it probably won't hit me until I'm on a Barclays floor and, I mean, it's friends and family in the crowd.
Speaking of homegrown products that are doing damage on the courts, we now transition here on Sports NYC back to the Bronx, where Timbo Gonzalez is doing plenty of damage playing some handball.
Hey guys, I'm Timbo Gonzalez, Rebel Pro Handball Champion, and welcome to my party.
He's a New York City playground legend, and he's coming to a court near you. No hoop needed, no equipment necessary. Meet Timbo Gonzalez, inner city youth turned professional handball star.
I was out here about 7 years old. That's when I moved down out here to Kingsbridge area. So growing up, it was really hard. You have drug dealers, on every corner. My friends got me involved in handball. It was just something different. I gave it a try, and instantly became addicted. It just kept me, you know, from hanging around the wrong crowd. That's like a big stress relief, so it helped me out so much. Like, I would go to school and I'll be like, damn, I can't wait to, you know, get out of school and, you know, go play handball. And it's just like so addicting. I just always wanted it. It was always on my mind. Like, I couldn't like really think about nothing else. Just play handball.
A Red Bull athlete, Timbo went from King of the Park in Kingsbridge to King of the Courts around the city. And today, he owns the urban jungle, no matter where it is.
I took a lot of L's, so I just always wanted to keep playing. And that's what, like, I think was the best thing, that I never gave up. When I got, like, my first win in the game, it just, like, boosted my confidence level, you know? And it's like once you get that taste, it's like you want more. Keep as consistent as I can, get to everything, and just put pressure on them, you know, kind of wear them down, get them exhausted, you know, have them running side to side. You know, just go in there comfortably. Like, if you know you're the best, basically. July 30th is going down at Van Cortlandt Park. Red Bull Slaps Don't Miss It. It's going to be one of the greatest events. I'm just excited for everyone, you know, who's been waiting on this tournament. We have people training really hard. We have people coming, you know, from out of town. Three-time champ at the Red Bull Slaps. I will definitely be looking out to see who could pull out, you know, the tournament, because it's going to be interesting this year. Come out, you know, maybe if you want to try it out, give it a try. I guarantee you're going to have fun and just, like, enjoy it. Get a ball for a dollar and just go out there and have fun with your friends. Be active. It's a great sport.
September is also a month of reflection with the anniversary of 9/11 and the Orchard Beach Car Show every year in the Bronx. It remembers.
This is our 16th year, and we normally have over 2,000 cars that come out, and you can see a great array of cars. We have the old timers like myself, who are from the 60s and 70s, even some guys from the 50s who are bringing their cars here. And then we have the young people with their rice rockets and the Asian cars. So we have a wide variety of cars. Everything we collect is donated back to the community.
You love cars. You've been doing this year after year. What makes you want to come back year after year?
Oh, it's just a love affair. I mean, look at it. Look at all these cars. They're gorgeous. To us, it's artwork. You know, people put their time and love. My grandson's 4 years old. He actually helps me wipe the car down and clean it.
When we can make someone happy, when we can make someone feel something, we'll have a memory that they can attach to, and then we can come together, you know, in celebration of a charity, of a celebration of or a memorial of 9/11. That, you know, we can be a part of that. It's humbling, actually.
It's very humbling, you know, to be celebrated that way. But it's very nice, and I'm glad for the influence that our show had on the world. And
that we can keep smiling about it, you know? It's a smile.
And hopefully people will remember, not our show, not us, but what really they care about, what we really care about, which is each other.
That's all the time we have here on Sports NYC. We wanted to thank our guest Mike Mancuso of WFAN. We'll see you next time right here on Sports NYC.